Has Ajit sir joined as of yet? Acha, he is joining. Okay, Ajit Kumar sir has joined also. So, Vineet, you can now close this landing page. Yes, thank you. Good morning, Ajit Kumar sir. Should we start?
We can start.
Okay.
Yeah, good morning, sir.
Good morning, good morning.
Good morning, good morning. So, ma'am, we can start now.
Okay, sir. Okay. So very good morning to all of you, to our present students, and I'm so happy to see many of our alumni, past students today, and also there are students from other institute. And of course, my respected head of the department is here, my colleagues are here. So I welcome you all to the third special talk for the Archaeology Discussion Group of Deccan College for the running academic session. And today we have with us one of the most senior and a very well-known reputed scholar of our country, Professor Ajit Kumar sir. I mean, seriously, he does not need any official introduction, but just for the for all of us sake, he has been the he was the founder head of the Department of Archaeology in Kerala University in Trivandrum. Apart from that, he has been the director of social science. Besides being, he has held many important positions, academic positions. I'll just name a few. For example, he was the member expert advisory committee for export of non-antiquities by Archaeological Survey of India, Government of India, Tirchur Circle. Then he was the member of History Archaeology Research Consultative Panel on Pattanam Excavation. He was the member of expert committee constituted by the Ministry of Culture, Government of Kerala for the inscriptions of Edakkal Cave into the World Heritage List. Then he was the member of the core committee of Advanced Diploma in Archaeology and Museology conducted by Mahatma Gandhi University. He was also a resource person for UGC refresher course in history held by the Academic Staff College in collaboration with Department of History, University of Calicut. He's also very well known for his excavations at Vizhinjam and in Kumla Fort district of Kasaragod. He has published many papers both in national and international journal, and he has published more than 8 books if I'm not wrong. And most importantly, I would like to share this, my personal experience. I mean, of course, I came to know him when I was a student because of the SOSA conferences, Society of South Asian Archaeology conferences. And of course, later on, when I have joined Deccan College as a faculty, I have interacted with him on that capacity also. But I seriously feel that he's a teacher and a mentor in true sense, because I'm not even his direct student. But whenever I have felt any problem, yeah, I've gone to the field and I am documenting some rock art sites or prehistoric sites, I have always received help from him, no matter what time of the day. I've shared my photos with him through WhatsApp, and he has always responded almost immediately and always have guided us. So I'm really very thankful and grateful for the human being he is, for the teacher and for the mentor he is. And of course, he is a man of many talent. I think he can also play very good veena. So sir, with that small brief introduction of yours, now I would like to I mean, the stage is all yours. You may start your presentation. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Amrita, for this wonderful and kind introduction. It's a great pleasure to being interacting with our presenting for this forum in Deccan College. It's a nice discussion group, and thank you for inviting me to present on Rock Art of Kerala. And it's nice seeing so many faces who've been in Deccan College, you know, previously also. And being my alma mater, it's a great privilege for me to, you know, be associated with this institute throughout my life. And if I have made it to an archaeologist, I think a lot of credit goes to my institute, the Deccan College. So we'll go into the presentation. I hope it's coming on the screen, the presentation.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Now I'll go from very preliminary things to the rock art of Kerala later. First, I'll just discuss what rock art is about. Rock art includes the artistic creation of Homo sapiens sapiens done directly on unprepared rock surface of caves, caverns, shelters, or open rock formations. The rock art found on the wall of caves or caverns are also sometimes referred to as parietal art. So parietal art is basically, you find it only on the surface of the thing. So that is why it is often also called as parietal art, because it is found on the surface of the caves and caverns at times. On technical grounds, Julian Steward in 1929 broadly divided rock art into pictographs, that is rock paintings, and petroglyphs or engravings. And rarely, forms combining these two processes are also observed in rock art. Cupules is another form of creativity which is noticed in rock art. Some people, some scholars included it in rock art, some differ from including cupules in rock art. But nevertheless, it's a human activity, it's a human creation done as part of some sort of activity of mankind. Now, pictographic representations are generally created on rock surface in an add-on or additive process using natural colors. In the sense, pictographs appear on the rock surface as paintings. The paintings are done in an additive process or in an add-on process to the rock surface, where the colors are mixed in some additive medium, or they are the natural colors are used, red from red ochre, white from kaolin, green from the greenery, black from lamp black. These are some of the natural colors which are mixed with adhesives, either glue or natural glue, sometimes pit, sometimes fat of animals, and then it is actually applied onto the rock surface either by using a brush like material or using the hands itself. So it pictographs or drawings are actually done in a additive process, or they are added onto the rock surface generally by using an adhesive and things like that. On the other hand, petroglyphs are created in a tear of process or a detective process. So detective process is actually you are trying to remove the surface of the rock by either engraving on it or bruising it in the constant, actually rubbing with another medium which is harder than the rock surface, or by pecking it, by constantly, you know, pecking it at the surface. Also, you can actually create you can remove the surface and create a rock art. And the technique of creating cupules are actually also by a detective process. They keep constantly hammering it on a surface, then actually by, you know, constantly rubbing around it, you know, it creates a rather smooth surface in some of them at least. So so pictographs are done by an additive process and petroglyphs are done by a detective process. Now, these are a few examples of petroglyphs. Petroglyphs are found in India, right from Kashmir down to Trivandrum or Kerala and Kanyakumari coast in the south. Also, they have reported from Gujarat as well as and as well as from northeastern state, Meghalaya and Mizoram have also reported petroglyphs. Now, the one you see on your extreme left corner in the screen, these are the petroglyphs which are from the Leh Ladakh area, where apart from the local animals like ibex and other things, we have also representations of the Tibetan stupas which are represented, and apart we have also anthropomorphic forms represented largely on granitic boulders lying in the open. And we have in south, we have this representation which comes from Medical, which we'll be discussing subsequently. This representation of petroglyphs is from Siot cave in Gujarat, and these are again representations from the Manipur region, where you have the head of boss Mithun depicted. And these are actually part, many of these depictions are actually part of the activities connected with burial rituals and things like that. Similarly, recently, what has caught in the past decade or so, what has really caught interest is the large number of petroglyphs that have been found carved on lateritic rock surface right from Ratnagiri into Goa, into Karnataka, and also in Kerala. Large number of petroglyphs are found engraved in lateritic rock, and the ones along Konkan have been in limelight recently. These are the ones from Konkan, and this particular one which you see in the bottom is from Goa region, and this particular petroglyph with a man and some bulls represented is from Udupi in Karnataka region. And earlier bulls have been also reported from Belleri area in parts of, in northern parts of Karnataka, and these are actually bulls which have been reported close to a decade ago from the Kasaragod district of Kerala. Now coming to pictographs, some of the earliest pictographs which have been dated are from the caves which are Europe and as well as from Indonesia. This particular bull figure, very bison figure, which is very naturalistically painted in the cave in Altamira in Spain. And then you have the representation of a bovine from the cave in France, and also a pig which you is represented in a rock shelter from Indonesia. So these paintings, you can notice they're very naturalistically done paintings, and they date very early in point of time because of the carbon 14 datings which has been done on this, and also other methods which have been used to date these pictographs. We have derived very early dates for the ones in Spain, France, as well as from Indonesia. Now, in the Indian context, when we come, the most important of the rock shelters or caves which bear rock paintings or pictographs are the ones from Bhimbetka, which was discovered by V.S. Vakankar. And we also have a large number of representations in this particular group. Large number of groups are there, and large number of paintings are there dating from prehistoric times to almost medieval and even modern times. So Bhimbetka happens to be the only World Heritage rock art site in India, and it definitely holds a special position as far as rock art studies is concerned, because some of the earliest rock art studies were initiated in these caves, and subsequently many more rock art sites came to be known throughout, came to be reported from various parts of India. Now, cupules, as I said earlier, is another form of art, sometimes taken as a form of art and sometimes not. And some of the earliest representations of cupules come from Bhimbetka, which has been stated to go back to Paleolithic times, is lower or middle Paleolithic times, and then there is also the Darkhi Chattan in which is also in Rajasthan in Chambal Valley, and both these sites have yielded cupules. And Bid Narek, who has studied the Bhimbetka cupule, he says that it would go into at least to Paleolithic, lower Paleolithic phase. And he says that Paleolithic material was found lying over this particular cupule while excavations were done. So it goes back to lower Paleolithic phase. And similarly, Darki Chattan, which was also excavated by Giriraj Kumar, who's been closely associated with Bid Narek, also claims that some of the cupules found in Darki Chattan is actually actually dates back to Paleolithic times. But though it has been suggested by both these scholars, many Indian scholars, have challenged this particular opinion of these cupules going back to lower Paleolithic times or middle Paleolithic times. Cupules have been found from various contexts. Sometimes within a cavern, sometimes on open surfaces, sometimes on megalithic monuments. Now the representations at the bottom two are from Jharkhand, where many of the megalithic capstones are observed with cupules. Similarly, cupules have also been reported from megalithic context in Maharashtra, especially from the Vidarbha region. I think many people have reported it also from megalithic context elsewhere. I think Dr. K.P. Rao has reported it from megaliths from in the Andhra region, and he tries to trace the association with some of the constellations. Dr. Kanti Pawar has been able to notice this from some of the monuments in Chandrapur area, and similarly from Nagpur area also, cupules have been reported from megalithic context or on megalithic stone surrounding, sometimes stone circles and things like that. So this is a wide range of time and context. Now, rock art motifs, if you have to classify them, they can be broadly classified into three categories, basing on the style of the motif. So for the first category would be geometric or decorative. Second would be representational or naturalistic, like the ones you noticed in the caves in France and things like that. They're the naturalistic representation. Stylistic or abstract, where the motif is represented, whether human or animal, is represented in a stylistic or abstract manner. So geometric, representational or naturalistic, and stylistic or abstract representations are noticed in rock art. And these three categories can again be further subdivided on the basis of the stylistic treatment that has been done in this in undertaking this representations. They can be treated as silhouetted or decorative, partially filled, and also outlined. So silhouetted, when you stand opposite light and you take a photograph, the outline which you would see in dark, this thing, that would be something known as a silhouetted type of representation. But then you have the decorative ones, which sometimes the motif is there in outline, but also it is decorated internally by other motifs. Then also there are sometimes partially filled ones, where you have only partial coloring done within the outlined image, or sometimes it is only left as mere outline. So such representations can be noticed both in as pictographs as well as petroglyphs. Now coming to pictographs of paintings, they are done using locally available coloring agents like hematite or ochre red and its various shades, white or derived from lime or kaolin. And as I said earlier, these colors are mixed with water, saliva, animal fat, or vegetative glue, and then directly applied onto the rock surface using brush or hand. Now, just a peep into the history of rock art studies. The earliest reporting of rock art comes from China. Chinese philosopher Han Fei, who belongs to around 3rd century BC, in his work Han Fei Zi, discusses rock art. And so does Chinese geographer Shui. In his work Shui Xing Zhu, which is dated to around 4th-5th century, mentions sites with rock arts. And he also mentions the existence of rock art in India. Maybe when he talks about India, he must be mentioning of the present Tibet region or the Jammu Kashmir region, which he must be mentioning about. The earliest, with the Renaissance period in Europe emerging, and you know, during 15th and 16th century, a lot of countries taking expeditions to find new countries, or as part of trade activities, expanding their horizon. And you know, we notice that the Portuguese, the Dutch, and other Europeans had started to travel across the globe in search of new lands and things like that. So in that point of time, if these people who had taken up this travel also recorded some of the activities during their period of journey. And one of the earliest reports of petroglyphs from Brazil comes in the work of De Glos das Grandas do Brasil, which is published in early 17th century or 1618. So that's the, probably the earliest record, probably of Spanish origin, dating to around early 17th century, which mentions petroglyphs in Brazil area. And similarly, in 1921, we noticed that since more of expeditions were undertaken, Mozambique in Africa also brought to light rock art. And similarly, with expeditions reaching in Australia, in 1788, Arthur Phillip is supposed to have discovered rock art in Bantry Bay, close to Sydney. So with Europeans undertaking travel into different parts of the world, they also seems to have, they also recorded some of these activities in the new horizon which they were visiting. And thus we get a glimpse of some of these early rock art sites being reported right from early 17th century. And in Europe especially, rock art studies emerged into the forefront during the late 19th century with the discovery of rock art paintings from Altamira in Spain, as well as, you know, the caves from France in 1894. So in 1879, you notice the Altamira cave in Spain being discovered, and in France, some of these caves with paintings were discovered as in the 19th century, late 19th century, in 1894. Now, when we look into the history of rock art in India, we can divide it into the pre-independence period and as well as the post-independence period. So in the pre-independence period, the study of rock art was initiated by some of the European savants, especially British, almost contemporaneous to the rock art discoveries that was happening in Europe. So it's generally opinion that Carlyle, as early as 1867-68, noticed rock art from the site of Sohilghat in district Mirzapur in the Vindhyan Hills in central India. And he was also the first to suggest a prehistoric antiquity for rock art, because some of the animals which he noticed in the rock art were actually no more there in the locality. And he is the first to have suggested prehistoric antiquity to some of these rock art forms carved in Sohilghat in Mirzapur. And the first scientific article on Indian rock art was published as early as 1883 by John Cockburn on the petroglyphs in the rock shelters of Kaimur Range. And coming to South India, a few years after the initial discoveries in North India, Fred Fawcett, between 1891 and 92, he and his associates discovered rock art in the form of bruisings at Kuppagal in Bellary, in present Karnataka state. And subsequent to Fawcett's discovery of bruisings at Kuppagal in Bellary, some of the other scholars from followed him, and Moore Rockart was exposed from this area, and Herbert Knox actually reports many more sites than what actually was reported by Fred Fawcett from Coupergill. And Fred Fawcett is actually also credited of discovering the first Rockart site in Kerala. He's supposed to have visited Edekal twice or thrice, the first one being in 1894, and he made an in-depth analysis and study into the rock art of Edekal shelter, and brought out an excellent publication assisted by R.C. Temple in the Indian Antiquary in as early as 1901. If you go by the documentation, the interpretation which has been achieved by Fawcett and Temple in this article stands out even after 100 years, because of the simple fact he has tried to analyze various facets of these rock art, stylistic terms, in the terms of the motifs represented, its correlation with the society and things like that. Even today, this particular article which appeared in Indian Antiquary in 1901 stands as a perfect example of how European savants worked through their interest and hobbies and could make out very excellent publications in the field of their choice. And in subsequent years, there are many others who have contributed to rock art studies in India. There is John Cockburn, Robert Brucefoot, Manoranjan Ghosh, Mun, there is D.H. Gordon. They have all reported rock art sites from various places and contributed to the knowledge of rock art in India. Now, coming to the post-independence period, after there was a lull initially after the initial discoveries, the rock art studies again came into limelight, and the revival of rock art studies in India was again started with the discovery of Bhimbetka paintings by V.S. Vakankar in 1957. And subsequently, Yashodhar Madpal conducted further studies at the site basing on stylistic parameters, and he also has brought out an excellent publications on Bhimbetka. So to these scholars, both Vakankar and Yashodhar Madpal, lies the credit of analyzing the analyzing as well as stylistically and chronologically placing the large number of motifs which was noticed in the caves at Bhimbetka. And Yashodhar Madpal was also an artist, so much of the reproductions of the paintings which existed in Bhimbetka also came out as part of his effort in various publications and large scale circulation of such motifs among the reaching to the common man were actually resultant of the efforts of Dr. Vakankar and Dr. Yashodhar Madpal. Subsequent to these discoveries, the many scholars have come out with discoveries in various parts of the countries. Dr. A. and studies on rock art. There is Dr. A. Sundara, Dr. Sononi, Arvind Neumeyer, Dr. K. K. Chakravarti, Giriraj Kumar, P. Pradhan, and Chandramouli, K. Rajan, S. P. Thampi, Meenakshi Patik Dubhe, R. C. Bednarek, R. R. Brooks, M. L. Malla, Binodini Devi. They've all contributed to rock art studies in their region and enhanced our knowledge on rock art. Now, briefly trying to state, how does rock art studies contribute to archaeology? This is one question that has been posed. When you take up rock art studies, the general framework of mind is always that how can rock art studies contribute to archaeology or understanding past life? Now, unrecorded ecology and climatic history can be gleaned from the flora and fauna that is depicted in rock art. For example, you notice some of these examples, in the rock paintings, notice rhinoceros, ostrich, and even in European paintings, in central India, you notice rhinoceros and ostrich. They've been also confirmed from remains, bone remains from here and there, but they also observed in paintings. But some of these animals are not prevalent in the locality of the painted shelters, so creating this particular, you know, if you analyze this particular animal's behavior and the way it is currently located in us. With adequate water sources in some places where these animals are depicted and where they currently do not exist. So it gives you an idea, you can glean or you can have an idea about the environmental conditions, at least when these paintings were painted, from a study of these particular paintings. Now, in the European paintings, woolly mammoth have been reported from the Ruffigan cave in France. And, you know, even today, as the Arctic ice melts, you know, we keep getting reports of mammoth bones and sometimes quite intact sort of mammoth remains coming out from the Siberian region as the snow melts in different parts. So mammoth is represented along with humans. So when humans drew these mammoths in these cave interiors, it's obvious that he was actually he viewed these animals and then actually put them into painting. So these clearly exist, clearly gives us an idea that woolly mammoth as well as humans were almost living contemporaneously at some point of time, and due to climatic variations and other things, they must have actually perished from the in the area which they are currently not there. Now, there is also a possibility to understand the cultural history of mankind if rock art is probed in a proper manner. So it can also give you an idea about the social culture or the social life that humans had during the period when these rock art was painted. They can give you an idea of the costumes. They can give you an idea of the subsistence pattern, the hunting techniques, weaponry that was actually in use, agriculture, if ever it is represented, so agricultural kits, some of the domesticated animals, etc. can also be gleaned or can be understood by the study of these rock paintings. Now, a point that has been, you know, recently in the thing is that, you know, when was dog actually domesticated is, you know, a topic for research for some at least some scholars. So scholars have been trying to trace these paintings where actually to find out where exactly would we see the earliest representations of dog along with humans. So such sort of things, that is domestication, also can also be gleaned from these particular study of culture rock art paintings. Now, most of the motifs and symbols that are seen on rock art seems to fall into the realm and beliefs of supernatural or spirits. Actually, spirit, you know, are divided into beneficial spirits as well as evil spirits. Even in many pristine societies and many of these societies, you know, endemic societies, we still believe that many of the diseases are actually caused by evil spirits and things like that. And they need to be properly addressed to remove the malady. And as part of removal of these maladies, there are many ceremonies and rituals, you know, trying to remove the evil spirits and things like that. And so many of these seems to be belonging to the sphere of religious symbolism. Now, what are the possible reasons for creation of rock art? I said the bottom line is that the true meaning envisaged of rock art, you know, as envisaged by the creator, will never be known save for the interpretations we make of it. That is, any person, be it a child or a grown-up, if he does a painting or an artwork, what goes on in the mind of that particular person who is creating that particular painting or art will never be understood by the person who views it. So the interpretations of what we make of that art form once it is created is actually, as probably an art historian and as an art person, we might be viewing it in the perspective of art, its outline, its feelings, its color combinations, and things like that. So the idea that was envisaged by the creator will never be known to us, and we as art historians or studying rock art, we might actually look for the artistic aspect that is reflected in these creations. So there is the intangible part and the tangible part. The intangible is the beliefs which went behind, you know, the creation of these things. They will never be understood, but you can assess the creations of rock art from the perspective of art. Now, from that perspective, it has been assumed that rock art was actually, by some scholars, they would say that it was art for an art's sake, or it was part of some sort of leisure activity that rock art came into being. And there it is also suggested that rock art came into being as part of some rituals connected with totemism, animism, or activities related to shamanism. Shamanism is still vogue among many of the ethnic communities in India, in various parts of India, and so is totemism and animism. They have subdued itself in from the true manifestations which were earlier, but nevertheless it continues to exist in our society even today in many parts of India. Now, sympathetic magic, hunting magic, or fertility magic is also some of the theories that has been put forward by scholars. Yes, in certain parts, yes, even we do get evidence of, you know, this hunting magic being vogue, but with restrictions of, you know, hunting imposed by the government, this is being reduced. But nevertheless, this was practiced in some form is definite. And fertility magic also it was vogue, and it still is vogue, but the sacrificial aspect has been reduced, and so is the motives representing. This fertility magic has been reduced, but they were done actually by the sympathetic magic, hunting magic, or fertility magic was basically done to ensure the clan the success of hunting expeditions, as well as fertility related aspects, or even fertility relating to crops and domesticated animals and things like that. So domesticated animals also, if they fall ill, they were subjected to, you know, some sort of magical rituals, so that evil would be eliminated. And similarly, rock art has been also associated with witchcraft, black magic, occult, believe in ghost or spirit, both ancestral and evil, and also exorcism. Now, the aspect of black magic or occult or something to do with exorcism has been proven beyond doubt by studies. In many parts of the country, you notice that rock art is found in either in inaccessible heights or in certain dark pockets of the shelter or the cave where it is painted, and it was not intended for personal viewing. So definitely there seems to be some sort of magical equation working towards creation of many of these motifs in dark interiors at very great heights where it is not easily possible to reach. So they should have erected a scaffolding or stood on some sort of bamboo or some sort of creations to make these creations at such a great height. So creation of such rock art motifs at height or in interior of cave. Even in Europe, you notice that some of these motifs are carved, are done in the deep interiors where the light even does not enter, and even the oxygen levels are less. And some studies done in, especially in Africa, they say that shamans are responsible for the creation of rock art in large parts of Sahara and other African countries. Shamans actually are responsible for the creation of rock art as part of some of the rituals which were undertaken in as part of some magical rituals which were undertaken. So they also say that some of these shamans have a holonization process initiated by various drugs or various other you know, natural products in order to achieve that particular state of you know, hallucination, where they could create such beliefs. So witchcraft, magical, occult is something which has been you know, as resulting in rock art work has been already proven by studies conducted in many places. And also it could have been created by to gain merit during hunting operations, or you know, thanksgiving of, you know, a curative thing that has happened in their life. And there are also various suggestions that some of these motives, especially those cupules and things like that, or even a rock art, could have been done by shepherds who were trying to avoid boredom. So when they were sitting, they just, you know, drew something on the ground, or, you know, painted it in some shelters. And some would also say that some of these cupule markings or some of these rock workings were also used as lithophone or making sounds in order to draw the grazing cattle or goats and things like that. So basically, these have been all aspects which have been responsible for the creation of rock art. And in many places, be it in Odisha, be it in Kerala, in Tamil Nadu, we commonly hear the term that as Ilithar Guha, Lekha Modi, and these are some of the terms which are used. Ilitha is actually writing, Lekha is also writing. So Modi means cave, Ala here, Ilithala in the local parlance, or Ilitha Guha as in some of the parts of Tamil Nadu, indicate that these caves or shelters were actually part of some sort of had housed some sort of writing or of a pre-literate society. So these writings of a pre-literate society can be, you know, symbolic. It could induce, it could be carrying some meaning which we can only interpret, but they seem to carry some sort of, also seem to communicate with the common folk, some sort of unsaid language by these sort of drawings. So it's also considered, basically rock art is also a representative of the pre-literate society. It's not that it's always pre-literate. Some of the literate societies also have produced. Now, what are the methods of study of rock art? Now, methods of rock art study of the first would be in the exploration and the discovery. And some scholars believe that the use of the term discovery is only viable and prudent if the rock art site has been found from remote terrains, isolated from human access, or within blocked caves. So discovery is something, you know, many do not take it as a right coinage unless it is found in very inaccessible localities, observed for the first time by the explorer, or it is found within buried or blocked caves. Now, actually, the discoveries are followed by documentations of site, the environment, the motifs itself, that continues. The rock art, you know, though it has, because it is generally connected with beliefs, spirits, and things like so. At some point of time, they have a universal denominators, and they are also modeled out of certain local characters and beliefs when it comes to their representations in rock art. And rock art, even you evaluating the social factor as well as the environment and the climate and other factors, when you're relating it to some of the motives related, it becomes interdisciplinary. So interdisciplinary studies are actually mandatory as part of rock art studies. And rock art studies is actually a reflection of human endeavor. So hence it has been also associated with anthropology and also from as part of archaeology, right from very early times. And it's just really this association is very true and it could be so it can be justified. But if you have to go in depth into into the theoretical aspects of rock art studies, the rock art needs to be studied contextually, from the context which is prevalent, cognitively trying to understand the intangible meanings that are associated with, and also related to the concepts that were involved in behind those motives which are represented. Now, contextual studies involve the theory, the visual culture or art history, and there are actually compulsory parts of or features in rock art and design. So that is the part of the theory, visual culture and art history component would be the main components of the contextual study. Cognitive study involves the study of emotions, feeling and inner psychological drives with respect to the creations of the rock art, whether it is as a spiritual field or holonization and such things, is the mental framework that goes behind the creations of these particular rock art is part of the cognitive studies. It could be psychological, emotional, those aspects are part of the cognitive study in rock art. Now, the next would be conceptual studies. Now, in conceptual studies, the concept or the idea behind creation of these rock art motifs is very clear in the mind of the creator. So, in this sort of representation, the concept which has been formed or basically achieved over a period of time by the creator, his ethnic clan or other clans in general, they would actually take precedence. The concept would actually take precedence the way it is represented, whether it is in the traditional aesthetic form or the technical aspect or the material that is concerned in this particular production. These sort of time things make actually form the bracket of conceptual study. So in the conceptual studies, you have something of an iconography emerging in rock art, where a particular cognizant or particular idea or concept is developed into a certain fixed pragmatic manner, so that only finds representation in rock art. So these are very technical issues. We can put it in very simple terms. In simple terms, scholars have tried to study rock art in very many ways. The first would be the documentary type. In actually, if you locate a site, you are actually documenting it. You are trying to describe in a descriptive manner the various rock art sites in the site in general, its location, its other different parameters, whether it is stylistic or the content, content wise, you are actually documenting and describing it. Conservation is it's not a game of every person who discovers a rock art site or who documents it. Conservation requires specialities as far as rock art is concerned. So the only alternative is to try and let technically expertised group trying to handle in the conservation of these rock art. So documentary is descriptive documentation is something which actually is the most common way of dealing with rock art after its the so-called discovery or after its find. There are also philosophical ways to understand it, trying to argue philosophically argue and present your case as to how you deem them to be important or connecting to the various social parameters. There is hermeneutics or the theory of stand of art interpretation. The art interpretation, as I said earlier, it can be an assessment of the motives, the style, the superimposition sometimes which you notice on these rock arts in the rock art sites, and also you can try to figure out the dates by basing on the superimpositions or some of these artistic impressions that is created on this particular by these motives. Now, many times art is based on comparative studies. So sometimes if one particular site is already been described as certain motifs belonging to a particular chronological bracket. It's quite common for people to interpret it carry the same bifurcations or chronological classifications into other parts, but that has to be done prudently. Otherwise, it can actually result in very wrong sort of interpretations. Similarly, semiotics or semiology again is the study of symbols and its significance and meaning from psychological. They say that symbols, they generally carry, they might change in its rudimentary form from prehistoric times to modern times, but still they include or retain some of their, basic symbolism and character, even if then when they are made today amongst our people. So semiotics or studying and understanding signs and symbols, which is represented in rock art, is also an interesting form. It exists in rock art and also it exists in things. Only the meaning and interpretations of things may have actually varied over the period of time. But if you go deeply into certain symbols which are used, it definitely would reflect that the commonality of strand or the belief still holds good in many of these motifs. So semiotics is the study of signs and symbols. Now, rock art can also be studied from the environmental factor or spatial factors, its distribution and landscape and things like that. And also from the stylistic, as I said, typology style. And rock art can also be studied from ethnological perspective or ethno-rock art. So in these, actually, you're trying to understand rock art with the various ritual and practices which are there today among the ethnic groups of the past, and its continuity in present rituals associated with shamanism, fertility, death, and lifestyle. If you intricately try to analyze some of these rock art motifs with these sort of things which are practiced by ethnic groups in rather relatively isolated pockets, they do seem to show some sort of continuity. As I said, the artistic liberty given to the artist who makes these creations today might vary from the artistic liberty or artistic output that was put during in the period when the rock art was done. But definitely, somewhere along the line, these two seem to have a common undercurrent or lineage. Now, rock art needs to be dated either by scientific means or relative methods. Scientific methods are definitely emerging. Relative date continues to be the most popular in India. As I said earlier, some sites have been dated in relative terms, and many scholars have tried to continue those interpretations into various regional areas of their work. And all these way of interpretations have their own advocates as well as their critics. Now, as I said earlier, dating of rock art continues to be the most challenging part of the studies. Relative dating methods rely generally on style reflected in technology or comparative parameters, and absolute dating methods are generally carbon-14 and uranium series, etc. Now, from abroad, we have actually radiocarbon dates for Short Cave in France, which is yielded about 35,000 years BP for those in France. Similarly, the Uliba Cave in Romania is considered to be around 3,000 years old, again, basing on carbon-14 dating methods. And in Nevada in USA, petroglyphs in Winnemucca Lake has been radiocarbon tested for the carbonate layers which overlie these petroglyphs, and a date ranging from around 14,800 to around 10,300 years been suggested for the Nevada petroglyphs in USA. And more recently, uranium series of dating method have been applied into for rock art in some of these European countries. And Altamira has been recently studied again by Uranium series of dating method, and they have come to a conclusion that all the paintings or all the pictographs in Altamira cave in Spain are not belonging to one and the same face. This is such case in many of the rock shelters or caves in India too, but nevertheless it has not been studied in an immaculate way. But Altamira's cave in Spain, which was earlier thought to be done in a single phase of a period of have now by Uranium series, you know, stated to range between over a period of over 15,000 years. So the same space has been used by many, many generations of people to have their execution of rock art. Similarly, more closer home in Indonesian group, in the Uranium series has been used to date colorad speleotherms, which are associated with some of the hand stencils found in Sulawesi in Indonesia. And this particular technique of colorad speleotherms dating has yielded a date of around 39,000 years from in the Indonesian area. So the absolute dates, both carbon 14 as well as uranium series, have now pushed back the antiquity in Europe as well as Asia of rock art into Upper Paleolithic and all into during the Pleistocene period. Now, coming to dates in India, worked hematite or red ochre nodules have been recovered from Lower Paleolithic contexts in Hunsgi, and some rock working in Bhimbetka and Dharki Chattan in Rajasthan has also been suggested to go to Lower Paleolithic times by Bednarak and Girijagopal respectively. And as I said, there are very few takers for this particular theory put forward by Bednarik and Girijagopal, who tried to assign it to Paleolithic period. And these two scholars have also tried to bring in new classification or new methodology, trying to classify or trying to bring rock art into the group of science. So they say that rock art science, but again that also has very few takers, because rock art, when you talk about art, it is fashioned, it is basically decided by the artist, the mental thoughts of this particular person who creates it. And studies in Africa have shown that shamans are in a holonistic state, and they are in a trance state while they make many of these rock art creations. So how can a man or a shaman be in a trance state who makes this particular rock art, you know, classified, how these resultant creations can be classified into science, I wouldn't know. But definitely science can be induced into rock art studies in certain parameters, but not into the general parameter. You can't probably go and classify rock art as a science. However, that opinions are left to those scholars. Generally, it is said that the rock art antiquity is it commenced during the Upper Paleolithic period and with possible extensions into Middle Paleolithic, and some would say that it goes back even up to around 40,000 BCE. Now, the early phase of rock art activity seems to be largely from Mesolithic phase, with possible extensions into Upper Paleolithic phase, and there is, you know, some of the portable art seems to indicate on this particular theory. The portable art or a core from Chandravati in Rajasthan with certain lined drawings on it or lozenge type working on it, and some ostrich eggshells which have been worked or decorated with, found from various sites, have been reported. At least partner site excavated by Dr. Sali has given a date of around 5,000 BP for the worked ostrich eggshell. So though this date is accepted, some which have yielded, you know, dates beyond 25,000 BP have not been, you know, uniformly accepted by scholars. So despite rock art in India, you know, almost definitely for sure, starting with Mesolithic or Upper Paleolithic period, in the Indian context, a large chunk of rock art in India, we will only go to, you know, historical periods, right, from early historic down to medieval and late up to modern times. Major chunk actually goes to the historical period. Even when you classify some of these rock paintings as prehistoric, they are not based on true dates that have been derived from direct dating of the material or the patina which is there on the top. It is dated basically on stylistic grounds, and stylistic grounds is not a very reliable medium to date some of these things, because it till pre-independence or even today, there are certain very remote pockets where even people don't know whether elections have happened and things like that. So you can't judge everything with the same parameter. So sometimes, you know, the use of bow and arrow continues even in today in Odisha and some parts of even Tamil Nadu. We have some in Kerala also, we have certain tribe groups, you know, using bow and arrow for hunting animals. So if you see a bow and arrow person in rock art painting, it needn't be that they go to Mesolithic or Upper Paleolithic or early phase. So it is for sure that some of these animal forms which have been represented may go to Mesolithic or even Upper Paleolithic times. But all the human forms that are represented, you know, according to Amri that is depicted, probably they did not go to the same phase of time. So they need intricate analysis to, you know, classify them. So major chunk of rock art in many of the sites throughout India, they go to historical periods only. Now, this is some of the portable art that was recovered from India. We had this particular an artifact from Belen Valley, which was initially thought to be some sort of mother goddess, but subsequently most scholars say that is part of a harpoon which is actually eroded. And on the these drawings are of ostrich cells which have been discovered with some working from various sites, and as I said, Patne in Maharashtra has been dated to around 25,000 BP. And this is the famous Chandravati core on which you notice these laws and designs done as, you know, in a linear fashion. So with this, we shall quickly move on to rock art in Kerala. Rock art in Kerala exists in the form of petroglyphs. And the first petroglyphs, as I said, was reported as early as 1901 in the publication in Indian Antiquary, written by Fawcett and assisted by R.C. Temple. And after a lull, there were pictographs were first reported from the Marayur Valley by S.P. Thampi in 1970s. And in later studies conducted by Thampi and also by Madhpal, they have tried to discuss, classify, and date the rock art following the parameters which were actually used in studying of the Bhim Betka paintings. So Dr. Thampi and Dr. Madhpal both were actually involved with Deccan College in their studies. Madhpal later actually, after his studies in Bhim Betka, he also created the first or published the first monograph on the rock art of Kerala. And when he did this particular work, there was only 7 sites which were known, but today there are over 40 rock art sites in Kerala. I have also come out with a publication on rock art in Kerala recently, which I have tried to include 30 sites, 15 petroglyphs and 15 pictograph sites, though there are more than that, some with very minor motifs here and there. Now, this is a distribution map of the rock art sites in Kerala. And physiographically, you have Kerala divided into, and at least by way of altitude, into 3 different regions: the lower coastland, the midland Lateritic Plateau and the Western Ghat area, where is known as Highland. So the rock art sites in Kerala, if you generally observe the petroglyphic, the sites with petroglyphs have a larger distribution in Kerala. They exist right from Kasaragod to Trivandrum district. However, the sites with pictographs are generally concentrated around the Mariur region, which is a rain shadow region east of the Moonar in Idukki district. So most of the rock art sites with pictographs are actually concentrated in Mariur region, which is around 40 kilometers by road west from the famous hill station of Moonar in Idukki district. So these are the 30 sites which I was mentioning, which have been discussed in my work. Now, coming to location and setting of rock art sites. And if you observe some of these major sites in Kerala, be it Edakkal, Atala, Vayumala, Mandottimala, these sites actually, from the place where these rock art occurs, you get a very panoramic view of the valley that surrounds that particular area. So you know, the valley or the location which gives you panoramic view of the valley have also been, you know, sometimes inspirational in executing the rock art in that particular area. It's not only in Kerala you notice that, some of the European countries also you notice, and also in other places you notice that rock art are found or you know, placed in such locality which offers, you know, breathtaking view of the valley or the mountains and things like that, have been selected to, you know, place these particular rock art motifs. So locational setting seems to be an inspiration in putting up rock art in certain sites. And it is also noticed that some of these rock shelters like Edakkal or Eduthupara, Thovarimala, Angkod, you notice that there is superimposition of varied periods in that particular, in these sort of shelters. So it indicates that there was some sort of preference for that particular locality. Be it spiritual or animistic, that was attached to that particular area, for that area being constantly being used as a place of worship or you know, place of reverence, to have these motifs placed over a period of time at the same location. So there is some sort of spiritualistic or animistic importance attached to certain sites, because you notice a lot of overlap over the period of time in the same particular cave. And for example, Edakkal and Eduthupara has been used for centuries. Now, at Edakkal, what is interesting is that Edakkal, it has two shelters, one at the lower level and the upper level. The lower shelter has also a water, a perennial stream emanating from it. The lower shelter does not have any petroglyphs in it. It is only in the upper shelter that you notice petroglyphs in Edakkal, clearly indicating that in studies conducted even in Tamil Nadu and even in some other foreign countries, what is noticed is that generally the petroglyphs or pictographs are noticed in sites or in shelters, in rock art caves or shelters, which are not habited. So that has been reported even in Kerala as well as in Tamil Nadu, that many of the shelters where these paintings or pictographs occur, they were not habited. They were probably place of some sort of spiritualistic or ritualistic importance, and that is why they have not been habited. The upper story of this Edakkal shelter is habited. Lower shelter is not habited, and it probably was habited area, and that is why we do not see any pictographs or petroglyphs in the lower shelter. So generally, rock art has been sites where rock art motifs have been repeatedly carved over a period of time. They seems to have some sort of spiritualistic or animistic or ritualistic importance. Now, as I said earlier, many of these shelters offer panoramic view of the surroundings, and some of these you know, hills have also been associated with some of the Now, this particular picture is of a long shot of the Edakkal Hills, which houses the Edakkal shelter. And you'll notice as though there is a huge female reclining, and she's identified also with Tadaga, who's associated with, you know, the Ramayana stories and things like that. So some of them actually also have association with later you know, epics and things like that. And what is interesting that some of these rock shelters with hood like canopy, this is actually a rock shelter from Marayur, Eduthala or Pattipara. Patti means actually hood, so the rock stands out you know, as a hood of a snake, and the interior actually also acts as a shelter. Now this particular shelter contains some of the earliest pictographs, and also has been put to use right from very early times to very modern times. Now, if you go by the geological and environmental settings, as I said, that there have been representations of lateritic surface in a series of places in the Kasaragod district, and also in Malappuram district, you notice that in the lateritic formations of the Midland region, you notice petroglyphs have been carved. Now, in Wayanad region, generally it is actually the most common medium continues to be granite. However, in Wayanad Plateau, which is also which has extensions into Mysore Plateau, you notice that there are one or two sites where soapstone has been or schist has been used to engrave these motifs, and one of it is at Kapikum. But generally, if you notice, many of the shelters is actually of granitic origin, and they are not caves, they are shelters, because cave is actually more seen in sandstone and other mediums where, you know, there is erosion. Some of these erosions create stalactite, and stalagmites also actually produce natural caves, but granites do not actually create natural caves or caverns as such. At the most, they might form shelters, in which some of these shelters find you have rock art representations. So generally the material of these geological material is granite, and these are the material commonly seen: lateritic soil, granitic. This is lateritic soil where you've seen it largely in Kasaragod district, granite from Edakkal, soapstone again from the Wayanad region, and various shades of granite where you observe either pictographs in white or in red and other colors. Now coming to lateritic petroglyphs, this Etteduka, which is located in Kasaragod district, was definitely one of the earliest to be reported in laterite. And what you notice here is actually large bulls, sometimes singly carved, or sometimes you have them in a row, one behind the other. Now, what is interesting is that if you observe the direction in which these animals are proceeding, further east of this particular site, what you notice is extensive grazing lands for cattle. So whether, you know, some point of time these animals moving in the same direction was a signboard for cattle grazers who came into the region is something which we need to ponder about. So sometimes it could be like stated earlier, it could be the work of cattle grazers who left their mark for people who migrate seasonally into different parts in search of fodder for their cattle. So this could have acted as some sort of signpost by sort of people, cattle breeders or cattle raisers. Now, another interesting site recently reported, I think 3 or 4 months back it was reported. I visited the site. It is known as Ariyattapara. It is close to these, it's hardly 3 or 4 kilometers from this rock art site where bulls have been represented. What is interesting is that I went along with my family to the site because initial reportings of this particular site which appeared in paper. It seemed very interesting, so we visited that site, the site. And what is interesting is that this site has actually given us two anthropomorphic figures along with bull figurines. This is the uniqueness of this. This is the first time that anthropomorphic figures have been observed in lateritic rock as petroglyphs along with bulls. Earlier bulls were reported from the site which I just showed you, but this is for the first time that you notice that these anthropomorphic figures along with bull figurines have been reported from Ariyattapara in Kasaragod district. And it's not only here, you notice extensions into all along the Konkan coast. You notice these sort of anthropomorphic figures. This one is from Bingri, which is from Maharashtra. This anthropomorphic figures, we have other sites also where you have reported this particular anthropomorph associated with bull figurines comes from Kullur in Dakshina Karnataka, or you know, in Karnataka. And this is from Osagalimil in Goa. You notice these anthropomorphic figures. All these figures are carved in laterite. So there is some sort of connectivity between the lateritic pictographs which exist in along the Konkan coast. Now, earlier also it has been suggested by Satish Lalit and things like that, people, scholars like that. Now, Viridi was one site which was in probably in Sindhudurg district, which had representations of, you know, these bull figurines. Similarly, in Gauli in Karnataka, on the right, you have Osagalimil, again from Goa, which has representations of cattle in laterite. And also we have in Gauli, which is also located in the present Mangalore region or Udupi district, where you notice these bull figurines. So there seems to be some sort of continuity of all along the Konkan coast of these motifs in the lateritic formations. And it's quite possible these lateritic formations or these bull figurines and things were carved by, you know, cattle grazers who migrated along with their livestock along the Konkan region. In the drought in Gujarat, which happened in 80s, early 80s, we had, you know, cattle grazers coming all the way up to even Kerala from Gujarat during that particular period of drought. Similarly, you know, even in Kasaragod district today, we have certain communities from Maharashtra who live in this particular region. So it's quite possible that at some point of time, there was some migration of these cattle grazers into along the coastal regions into Kerala, resulting in these bull figurines in Kasaragod district. Apart from the bull figurines, there are also some very interesting representations. The one in the top, they are from Bengalam. One, you have a leopard, which is also almost fleeing with his tail upraised. And another, you have a representation about 100 meters away from this particular representation, where you see a leopard which is either killed or tied up with its legs together, drawn together. So killing of leopard was also considered a sport, and this probably was again a signboard, because this leopard is you know, etched into or carved into lateritic rock, where it is close to a water source. And there are also some, you know, foot representations or foot symbols or feet symbols also carved into lateritic formations from Veliyapara, again in Kasaragod district. Now, Kapikunna or Veliyambalam Kota, again in Wayanad Plateau, is the only place where you notice, currently the only place where you notice petroglyphs carved into soapstone. And these representations include a deer, some foot impressions, and also some you know, impressions of verticals and horizontal lines. The most famous and the most prolific site with petroglyphs is the Edakkal Shelter, again located in Wayanad. the entrance from the north. You descend through a flight of steps, and as we descend, this is the most catchy area of the particular rock, which juts out slightly. And this area happens to be the focus of the initial artist who or the creators of the petroglyphs. And petroglyphs are found all along the surface along this particular side, and as well as along the both as you enter the right and left. This would be the right and this would be the left as we enter into the cave. Further along this particular cave, when you descend, the further along the southern part is open to sky. Now this is not a cave as some people would say, but it's a shelter. Actually, there are this rock and these are two independent rocks. Actually, between these rocks, there is a cleft, and large rocks have come and fallen in between these rocks, actually, thus resulting in a sort of shelter. It's not a waterproof shelter. Water and sand, soil percolates from the top into this, resulting in moss growth and also resulting in damage to these petroglyphs which are carved here. This is the left side wall, as you notice. Right from the corner of the particular shelter, right across up to the open space in the further south, you notice that petroglyphs have been carved of various nature. And these two images in the center seems to be the focus or the focal point of the excavation, and these was also possibly carved during the earliest these also happen to be possibly the earliest artwork in this particular cave. And since this area was filled, and this area is important, you will notice that the orientation of this animal, the elephant, is towards these two figurines. So also you notice a human figure walking across towards this main figurines. And since this, once this area became filled up with petroglyphs, area further from the main petroglyphs were actually taken for excavations. And since this two seems to be the most important representations here, human anthropomorphic representations here, the area which was left barren on towards the top, also was actually taken up for putting up various motifs forms. So stylistically, these two figures appear to be the earliest. As you notice, they have got a cylindrical form of human, or torso, cylindrical legs, and then upraised arms holding some sort of leafy appendage. They have also a headgear with probably leafy appendages. The face is not clearly represented in any of these anthropomorphic figures that are represented here. Now, this gives to, or this lends a feeling that some of these anthropomorphic figures which are carved are shamans, which are related to Bhuta cult or the Yakshagana cult or the Theyam cult, which is actually vogue even today. Because shamans, be it in Siberia or in Africa or in any other place, shamans do not reveal their original idea. Or in the Theyam forms also, which you see enacted in Kerala, you notice that the human face is not the original face of the shaman is masked by either masks or sometimes paintings or some other form. So shamans do not generally represent their face as it is. There is an ancient belief which is recorded in some of the Semitic texts like Bible and things like that, where it is written that a person who sees face to face with God would not survive. So maybe this has got a very ancient belief, and that is why shamans probably who interact between their society and or their clan and the spirit world. So it's quite possible that is why many of these shamanistic figures are actually not represented with the human face is not represented. It is always some sort of mask. They seem to be wearing some sort of mask and some sort of hairy bandy appendages over their head. Various stylistic forms are represented in Edikkal. You have torso with biconical torsos, sometimes also torsos depicted as in a triangular manner. So as I said, the scape is not a excavation of one time. Many periods of excavation, many periods of rock art activity has undergone in the scape, and the stylistic variation is definitely a parameter for measuring these particular sort of activities. Now on the right wall you enter, one of the most interesting figures is a anthropomorphic figure with bird like wings and a bird head, and there are also some figures which are shown standing in a very large form on ladders and things like that. This is again on the right wall. You notice that varied form of figures are carved, sometimes with broad hips as for representing a female, and at the hip it is denoted like a cross. Probably such symbolization of this, only this part is also later seen in some other representations noticed at Edekel. More of geometrical forms take over, and the representations of anthropomorphic torso with as two triangles is something which comes to exist during this particular period, during later period, and they also seems to be some sort of this particular style of having a triangular torso seems to develop during a later period, and it is also some one of these representations from Adichendallur pottery also seems to have this particular style. And once this sort of triangular sort of representations come into being, there are also representations where the female hip or triangular portion, triangles are represented, or some of the forms with only two crosses are represented, and some seems to be connected with the yoni worship or female fertility aspect, which is noticed here. And further, we notice that the thickness of this particular engravings also start to reduce over a period of time, and they come as merely as some sort of line-like formations, very thin and narrow lines. Some of these early representation you see them broad, and coming to more of medieval period, I think these representations achieve only they are probably created using very sharp instruments. That is why these stylistic variations are noticed. The ones which are sharp in itself, I tend to call it as a stylus style, where a stylus-like implement is used to, a sharp instrument is used to achieve these carvings or these engravings. And wherever the engravings are deeper, probably chisel-like instruments were used to in engraving these figures. There are the geometrical motifs are also there, ladders, crosses, circles with crosses, and very sometimes linear motifs are also noticed in the representations, apart from some carts, deer. And we also notice there are representations of, and there is also inscriptions in these particular cave towards the southern end, which is open to the sky. Now, close to the Edekel cave on its eastern side, recently in a place called Govindamulachera, petroglyphs have been noticed. There is also some deer-like animal on a boulder here. These are actually on boulders, open boulders. They are not in shelters. But nevertheless, some of these engravings do seem to have similarity with the genre seems to be similar to the one noticed in Edekel and in Thoberi caves. So these are some of the engravings which you noticed in the Thoberi shelter, which is also located close to Edekel. This is the Thoberi Mala shelter. It's a shelter, it's not a cave actually. And here again, you notice that the representations of having a triangular torso while representing human forms, which appear in the later period at Edekel, seems to be the stylistic genre here. And you also have those triangles and squares represented, probably again representing the yoni cult or the fertility cult. And apart from that, we have also cross and circles and some linear motifs, which you had noticed earlier appearing in Edakkal, also is part of the representation in Thowrimalla. Now, since these three are very closely located, who are the authors of these particular rock art creation is a point to ponder. Now, the first person to assign these rock art creations to Kurumbas was by Fawcett. Fawcett did a studies and he said that it probably Kurumbas had a association with this caves, because Kurumbas refused to enter this cave, while some of the other communities entered into this cave. And Kurumbas are actually associated with black magic in the Nilgiri region, of which Wayanad is a part. They were associated with black magic and things like that. So they were also dreaded by other tribes. So actually, Fawcett was the first to associate the rock art with Kurumbas. Fortunately, we have got a photograph by Breeks, which gives us a photo of a Kurumba hut. And this Kurumba hut, if you observe, with a man with a javelin seated and with his family, this particular cave is painted. Today, no tribal community in Kerala or any ethnic community in Kerala practices art on its wall as noticed in these Kurumba paintings. Certain places in North India, especially in Rajasthan and UP and Bihar, you notice that some of these huts, they are plastered and painted during the festival season with various motifs. But do not see any sort of paintings being practiced by ethnic community of Kerala as of now. So to interact with Kurumbas, it was learned that there are Kurumba tribes still residing in the Nilgiri region and who practiced rock art in that particular region. So Vellarikomba is one place where the Kurumbas tribes community still exists, and they also currently practice rock art. They practice the rock art motifs or motifs in paper and paint they actually execute. But this particular tribal community still maintains some sort of painting in their community, though it is being done on paper using a natural material. But close to Vellarikomba, there was also a rock cut site which the Kurumbas associated with their ancestors. So this particular rock cut site was visited in order to understand the pictographs there. And what we noticed that was there is large number of stylized anthropomorphic figures with very strange headgears in the paintings, which are carved. This is the where I'm standing, and much of the paintings are observed as high as this. So how did they achieve these paintings at such a height is something questioned. Probably they used bamboo or some things like that to stand and actually paint on this. Many of the other moving representations have large headgears, like the ones which we noticed in Edakkal and cave. So they also have some sort of decorations in dots, things like that. And also a deer is represented. And if you observe closely, that this particular area has been put to use over varied periods of time, as you notice that there are anthropomorphic figures which are superimposing the deer representation, which is shown in the background. So many representations have been done over a period of time. Similarly, you will notice two footprints and a huge chain connecting these two. So they consider that this was some sort of evil spirit which was actually causing problem, and this was actually tied up as a part of some ritualistic things which were done in this particular rock surface. Now, every year, the Kurumbas who stay in this Vellarikomba region, they actually, every year, for a week, they perform certain ritualistic function. Earlier, it used also involved animal sacrifices in order to strengthen these figurines which were actually carved here. Now, if you personally talk to them, they give you different names. There is Maladevam, Holy Devam, and they give them different names, and they identify it as some of the divinities connected with even today with their ritualistic aspects. And if you notice some of these headgears which are seen in these paintings and also in Edakkal, they seem to, you know, have the similarity with some of these Bhutha dance forms or Theyyam, which is enacted in North Kerala and parts of Karnataka. Now, these are actually the representations which they carry out in paper using natural vegetation. And this is the artist who is involved in making these. He is also a national award winner. And these are some of the natural material which is used in executing these. What is interesting is that none of these figures represent the, what they represent is actually social events only. They represent festivities and honey collecting and such things are represented in their in the current forms which they create. None of these figurines which they associate as divinities are found represented in these paintings, and they also are associated with they are associated with ancestor worship and things like that. And these pebbles represent, you know, the deceased ancestors, so they are also into ancestor worship. Apart from this group, which is around the Wayanad region, especially close to the famous Edakkal caves, similar engravings or petroglyphs have been also noticed in Eluthala at Puyamgutti in Ernakulam district, and also from Angod in Trivandrum district also, we have noticed some sort of the petroglyphs carved on granitic surface. There is various motives are there, hearing motive, or, you know, this clock face like motifs and things which have been carved. Now we'll quickly move on to pictographs which are found in Kerala. The largest concentration of early pictographs in Kerala occur in a place called Koodakkad. Koodakkad is in Marayur region. It is in the township itself, but you need a permission from the forest authorities to visit it. I visited it with also my family, and my son helped me in, you know, taking some of the closer pictures of these pictographs. Now, this is a digitally enhanced picture of what we just the pictograph which we saw, and you notice that actually there are three anthropomorphic figures which are noticed here. The one in the center is an anthropomorphic, which is the one quite similar to the ones we noticed in lateritic formations of Kasaragod district. There is one more anthropomorphic figure here, and another figure to the right. These are actually all blurred out. Only the one in the center is rather clear. And there are also many figures which are actually invisible to, you know, almost invisible to the naked eye, which needs to be digitally enhanced. So when you digitally enhance this figure, what we notice that there are a series of bull figures, and these bull figures appear to be the earliest in this particular shelter. The anthropomorphic figures whose face is again not clearly represented, probably, you know, having a bead or a, you know, or a typical head depicted only as a round with facial features not clearly demarcated. This anthropomorphic figure is done in two colors. You have a red ochre outline and white lines in the interior. This actually superimposes the bull figurines. So when this image is superimposing the bull figurines, it is clear that the bull figurines with epiphallic sort of organs and things like it is earlier to the anthropomorphic dwarfic figure represented. There is also the mountain goat and things like that depicted along with these representations. There are also the figures are represented in varied size. Some of them you have, the whole figure is filled in with colors, or sometimes they are only marked as outline. Like this is the Zambar deer, which is found in plenty in this particular region, and apart from the Nilgiri Thar, which is also depicted. And again, you can notice that some of the digital enhancing has resulted in a depiction of a deer, and other things have been brought out in this particular thing. There are other caves here, like Manala, which depict a pair of deer, and probably the birth of a deer or a fawn is probably depicted here. There are two here, and there is a small deer shown here. So some people say that it was the birth of this fawn that is actually, of this deer is actually depicted in this. There is also in the same place, Mana means actually deer. So this shelter where this painting is found is known as Manala. There is also a representation of a wild boar being hunted using a snare or a trap. So that is also a representation. The largest number of pictographs are found in Marayur is located in a rain shadow region, and that is one of the reasons that many of these pictographs have been still preserved in that particular area. You have a large series of motifs in this, and most of these paintings are of later period. Most of the people residing close to this area are of ethnic Tamil origin, and they still speak Tamil, and one of the major festivities associated is with the Palani temple, which is along further along these hills in Marayur region. Now here you notice that the Crockwell with people are shown. You also have some trident motifs which is there. Crockwells are actually made of wooden reeds of bamboo and things, and used for crossing the rivers as well as for fishing activities, etc. Apart from these things, you have also animals like dogs, elephant, and horses also are painted in this pictographs here. Horse is not a very native animal. Many of the horses which you see in the region are brought from actually Nilgiri. There are also the giant lizard, which has got this capacity to walk on rock surfaces in a bold fashion, though they have been repeatedly depicted in this particular cave, all in white color. And then there are also some peacock-like birds or peahen-like things, birds-like depicted. Also, some local fauna has also been depicted, like this in the wild plant and tree with its tuberous lower part. And such paintings that we noticed in Artala is also located or also found in some of the dolmens which are scattered around the Marayur region. Now this particular dolmen from a place called Anakotapara also has yielded us white paintings or pictographs quite similar to the one at Artala, and many of these motifs seem to be of a later origin. Now in Anakotapara we have also two pictographs which actually gives the name of a person in Tamil character. One is written Kuppam or something, so it clearly shows that this rock paintings or painting activity or pictographs were actually made into very recent times when the team from Deccan, our university, along with Akinori, Abhin and Rajesh visited the site. The person who accompanied them had told that when they were young, around 30 to 40 years ago, they used to visit these particular dolmens sit inside and sometimes also make such sort of painting. So the white paintings continued into later times, but you just based on the color, it's not possible to state whether the red color came into first use or the white color came into use later, because you notice that generally we say that rock art is done on unprepared rock surface, but here you notice that the rock surface has been prepared in a manner with the red ochre has been sprayed or smeared on the wall surface, and over that you have this trident figure. Now trident is one motif which is associated with Karupusami and things like that in that particular region. What is interesting is that along the white motif, which is done over a red background, we have an alphabet R. So this was done by some person who has his name starting with R, who knew English, and that is why probably he is given this graffiti of his first alphabet of his name here. And similarly, in some other shelters, you notice that here you notice that the red ochre color is superimposed by the white color. But there are also shelters where you notice that the white colored paintings of anthropomorphs are actually superimposed by some creations in red. So such superimpositions, gives vent to the feeling that the color combinations is not a definite factor while assessing the superimpositions or date of these things. Now coming to the third aspect, it will be examined actually pictographs and petroglyphs. And now we come to the cupules. Now cupules have been found from Thovarimala, Chullimeda, Chermanangad, and in Thovarimala actually the cupules which you noticed here are within the shelter. Now why exactly these were actually carved, they don't seem to be forming any definite pattern as such, but nevertheless it is found within the shelter of the particular cave at Thovarimala. And in Chullimeda actually you notice that they are found on a large rock surface just on the besides the roadside, and large number of cupules have been done along the surface. Now what is the reason behind particularly having such a lot of cupules executed on this particular rock here defies explanation. But there are also some places where the burial site at Chermangad, you notice that there is a capstone which is actually done with cupules on the top. Now as I said earlier, some of these cupules like K.P. Rao and some scholars have identified some sort of constellations in the representation of these particular cupules. So and as I said earlier, some megalithic monuments also have been associated with cupules from Maharashtra region, at least both Vidarbha, especially Vidarbha region has come out with some of these. Now assigning a meaning to some of these petroglyphs, pictographs and cupules it's difficult to comprehend the meaning, but it has been subject matter of many research and deliberation. Some of these pictographs do seem to show some relevance with social or religious practice, and some of the petroglyphs of anthropomorphic figures at Edikkal seems to have a reflection of non-Brahmanical animistic practices centered around Buddha worship or ancestor worship performed by shamans or oracles. And the coiffure and costume of some of these representations represent the pristine Theyam forms or Bhuta or ancestral spirit or Bhuta Kola, which is actually still vogue in parts of South Karnataka and North Kerala. Now, these are just some of the Edikkal figure with these sort of headgear with, projections, and the arms with some sort of appendages being held. You notice similar forms here also. These things are actually made out of palm leaves, which are palm leaves, and this sort of headgear is made because they also are light and disposable. Similarly, you notice that some of these palm leaves are held also by in the hands of these Tayum forms, which are actually, by, you know, in a way, creations of these ancestral worship tradition, which is there. Now, similarly, there are also some female forms with the large headgears on them. Here also, you notice a female figure with a large headgear. Here also, there is, this, these are nice representations from Edekil. And they seems, again, they also again seem to have a reflection in some of these Tayin forms which are enacted even today. So there seems to be, though, you know, the symbolism of these things exist, you know, they exist in a muffled fashion. And if you even inquire with the people who perform these Tayins, many of the people who perform Tayins are not from the upper religions of the society. They are essentially tribals and belonging to OBC or SE category, that many of these performers belong to those community. So they are actually the torchbearers of these pristine sort of enactment. And if you inquire with them for why those masked appearances or why these particular things, why are these appendages added, they would not be able to give a reply. They would only sum it up as traditions. So, but these traditions seems to have an hoary antiquity if you go by some of the representations which you see in Edekil. Now, some of these sort of representations, like of Bhutas or this thing, are also noticed in burial urns. These are three burial urns actually with ash depository inside. It's worshipped by a household. It was found in their property while digging, and it has ash inside. And you can notice that similar forms, which is the representations on the top of the pot, seems to have a similarity with this Bhuta cult or ancestor worship. Now, ancestor worship or having images of ancestors being done was reported by Mathir in his work, Native Life of Travancore. This representation is of an ancestor who was whose image was created, and it is reported in Mathir's work. And this is the representation from the book by Mathir. And similar ancestor images are also even today worshipped by some of the tribals. This particular representation was noticed with the tribal group from the Nilambur region of Palakkad. The Padinayakans actually own these two images. And you can notice that this has the continuity even in today in the Tayyum or forms, which is actually, or the Muthappan Tayyum form, which is actually worshipped in North Kerala. The only thing is that the Muthappan Tayyum is essentially an ancestral worship, which has been now incorporated or inculcated into Hinduism. And it is worshipped as a representation of Shiva and Vishnu form. This is represent, this murti is supposed to be the Shiva form, and this murti is supposed to be the Vishnu form. So they've been so popular, this ancestral worship was so popular in North Kerala, practiced by non-Brahmanical or the other communities like OBC or S, now classified as OBC, SC and ST. And but it was so popular there that the Hindu fold finally comes to accept these sort of traditions into Brahmanical fold and as Muthappan Tayyum and thing. And similarly, some of these representations in the Atala shelter seems to be associated, as I said earlier, then many of these people are from the Tamil community, and the Pongal is celebrated. Pongal and what do you call that? There are common festivals associated with Tamil Nadu. Thai Puyam, it is known as. Puyam is one of the festivals which is associated with Lord Muruga, wherein such forms are enacted, where human forms hang from the skin, in carts, and they have also water, milk, and also it is known as Peeli Kavadi, Tuka Kavadi, Pal Kavadi. It is also Kavadi, Thai Pusam is associated with Kavadi, and some of these paintings seem to represent those Kavadi forms which are actually enacted by the Tamil folk in the Marayur region. So they seem to be more of a leisure activity. related to the social life, which they are known as. And as I said earlier, in some of the caves, you have also some sort of synchronistic anthropomorph with bird-like head and things like that. What are these figures? We do not specifically know, but it has been founded also in painted form in Marayur region, and also it has been reported from in Tamil Nadu as well as in Karnataka. We have noticed these some sort of bird anthropomorphic figures associated with megaliths. So what exactly it is hard to define. There is also some motifs which seems to be part of shamanism, and shamanism, it is said that the shamans use a ladder like object to enter into the heaven or the hither space to discuss their issue with spirits and gods. So you know, such ladder forms have also been represented. Ladder as a motif or a means to access heaven has been codified in the Bible. It is also written in Buddhist sources that Buddha, in order to access his mother in Trishita, even used a ladder to visit her and even come back. So ladder seems to be a motif that has been carved with some of these shamanistic figures at the top of these particular ladder. And there are also, you know, some very human forms which are shown in a sort of stick-like manner, both in paintings as well as in pictographs as well as petroglyphs, and there seems to be sort of some late representations. And in some places, especially this pictograph is from Marayur, and this figure was anthropomorphic figure with raised arms is considered as a pay or a ghost. And they have webbed sort of fingers, and such representations are also seen in petroglyphs in Edakkal caves. Now, what is interesting is that in Bali Islands, with spread out arms is taken as a procession throughout the village, and that particular anthropomorphic figure is assigned with the duty of bringing into its fold all the evil spirits that are lingering in that area. So these sort of spread out arms and things like that, they seems to be associated with so many other ritualistic practices. And here this particular thing is identified with pay or ghost, and probably some occult practicism, or these are a resultant of some occult practices. And as I said, tridents are also associated with Shiva, and also with certain deities, which local deities, and they are worshipped. They are placed close to these megalithic dolmens and worshipped even today. There are also some representation like these feet impressions, which seems to represent deceased or souls which who have attained nirvana or who have attained moksha. Such representations are also found in certain insights, and this is actually a modern petroglyph where you can notice that the patina is not there and it looks very fresh. Some places, as I said, some of the motifs in certain places could have also acted as signboards of a preliterate society. And there are also some motifs which could go into the bracket of petroglyphs if they are, if you want to. But they seem to be, chess boards and, palangudi boards, which are actually carved on open rock surfaces. But these are both these things were located close to rock cut caves of 10th, 11th century. Now, fixing of date again for chronological bracket is in absolute terms is not possible. But Edakkal seems to be early based on the inscriptions. And the earliest attempt to date these caves on stylistic comparative grounds especially the pictographs of Anjanwad Valley. Dr. S.P. Thampi, you know, he tried to classify the paintings of Marayur. He said that, you know, some of these studies were already going on in North. So according to that basis, he said that it could go to Upper Paleolithic to Mesolithic and down to early historic period. But Dr. Mathpal, when he studied these rock arts in Kerala and brought out his monograph, he divided them into five phases. The first phase he felt was around 4,000 years of BP. And the second phase he felt could go to Neolithic, which is around 3,500 BP. And the last phases, third, fourth, and fifth, he said would belong to Megalithic period. But there are scholars like K. John Chandramouli, even myself, who feel that many of these rock pictographs and petroglyphs would only go to Megalithic period. And we will just try to make an assessment. As I said earlier, in Megalith, in Edakkal caves, the inscriptions are noticed towards the end of this particular engravings on the left wall. And there are, you know, there are four or five inscriptions which have been carved. Now, these inscriptions could have been carved here in the empty space area. But these inscriptions, which some of the earliest go to 2nd century AD, was carved in this open space towards the outer end of these place where petroglyphs were not present, because they did not want to disturb the petroglyphs which are already existent in this area. So if you date the earliest inscription in this wall, where this large number of petroglyphs exist, and the inscriptions are located at the outer end where no petroglyphs were there, it is obvious that in 2nd century AD, while the earliest inscriptions were carved, many of these petroglyphs existed during that particular period. So that is one assumption we can make. Now, earliest inscription on paleographic consideration, it says that it reads Koviputra Vira, and it is dated to 2nd century AD. There is also another 2nd century, 3rd century CE inscription which mentions a word called Ko Athan, which means King Athan is what it is interpreted to be, and he is taken to be a Chera prince ruling around 2nd and 3rd century CE. There are also some Tamil Brahmi inscriptions which reads as Kumati Putra Chera, also dating to 2nd century A, 3rd century CE. And so the earliest date for epigraphs found in Edakkal caves would be 2nd, 3rd century AD. So when 2nd century, 3rd century AD inscriptions were inscribed, there was definitely these engravings were present. Now later inscriptions, you know, some of these inscriptions, one of it goes to Vishnu Varman of the Kadamba family, which is dated to around 5th, 6th century AD. And there is also another inscription, which is probably of a later period. So if you consider the earliest inscriptions, then from 2nd century onwards, while 2nd century, 3rd century, these inscriptions were carved, the petroglyphs were already present. Now, if you push back the antiquity of petroglyphs, even by 1,000 years beyond the earliest inscription dating to 2nd century AD, even then it would only go back to around 800 or 1000 BC. So 800 to 1000 BC has already been derived as through C14 method of dating for megalithic phase in Kerala. So definitely many of these rock petroglyphs in Edakkal, which is considered one of the earliest sites, would only go back to the megalithic phase. And there are many megalithic monuments, both as urn burials and dolmens and cist existing in Edakkal, in and around Edakkal. So many of these petroglyphs in Edakkal do not seem to be going beyond 1000 BC, and 1000 BC is also already a date, C14 date, we have derived for megaliths in that part of Kerala. Now, similarly, when we come to dating the pictographs, we do notice that Marayur region has a large number of dolmens scattered around. And many of these dolmens, you notice that ashlarani or rock cut and masonry vault has been built around them. Now, ashlar masonry of using cut stones in creating walls are actually datable. The earliest ones probably are datable only to the Pallava period around 7th century CE. So whether all these megalithic monuments which you see in and around Marayur with which these paintings are associated are early, it seems doubtful, because many of these dolmens which exist in Marayur region seem to fall during the historical period, especially 5th, 6th, 7th century onwards. Even in the tribal belief, they would say that there was a war between some kings and they migrated during the period of that war into that particular region. So it's quite possible that many of these megalithic monuments are not quite early as they are considered. They might only belong to the historical period. And some of these motifs which are actually seen on the paintings are also related to some of these tribe groups which are prevalent there. Now, Kada tribal uses a bear of bamboo and in their burials, and such bears things are also noticed in some of the rock paintings which are seen in the Marayur region. Similarly, many of these places also have Tamil script, clearly indicating that many of these paintings or pictographs are not as early as they seem. There seems to be a continuity of the painting tradition even into later times. Some would definitely be early, mostly belonging to megalithic phase itself, and then continuing into medieval and later period. And what is interesting is that I had shown this picture earlier of trident with an letter alphabet R. Similarly, in Patipara, we had noticed an inscription here. We were not sure what script it was, but however, when we highlighted it using, technique, photographic technique, we noticed that the name written here in this particular point is Kala Bharat Bhayan. So these are actually, now it is almost faded in its nature, but this inscription is written in English, so it should be by some tribal person who lives in the close vicinity, who put their names, and he was educated at least in the English to have put his name in English. So this clearly brings out to the point that red ochre was not just used in prehistoric societies, it was even put into use by modern people to write their names there. Now, coming to the concluding observations, the earliest rock art seems to be petroglyphs from Edekil, and they do not seem, as I said, go earlier than 1000 BC. And 1000 BC is already a date which have been, C14 dates have been got for megalithic period in Kerala, from Mangada, and we have also Kutikol, which is at a date of around 800 BC for megaliths in North Kerala. So much of the chunk of petroglyphs and pictographs in Kerala only fall into the bracket of 1000 BC and later. So there seems to be that many of these pictographs and petroglyphs seems to date only to the megalithic period, and they do not seem to be associated much with the prehistoric period, be it Mesolithic, Neolithic or Chalcolithic, because we do not get evidence of any Mesolithic or Neolithic or Chalcolithic habitations or things, vestiges close to these sites. Yes, the Plateau of especially where Edekil is located, some stray reportings of Neoliths have been there, but putting these two together does not seem to be quite relevant. So it's more that we emphasize that much of these rock art belongs to megalithic periods. And even if we push the antiquity of the pictographs from Marayur region, they also seem to be, you know, safely going into the megalithic, historic, medieval, and modern times. This is the book have published, Art Group History, Petroglyphs and Pictographs in Kerala, Rock Art in Kerala. It is published by New Bharatiya Book Corporation, New Delhi. See, these are some of the articles which I have written on rock art. And I owe my thanks at the outset to first to Dr. Bansilal Malla of IGNCA, who initiated me into study of rock art in Kerala. My wife, Usha, son Raj, and my daughter-in-law, Veena, they're all companions in many of my field trips. And from the department, Dr. Rajesh, Dr. Abhin, Dr. Sri Ranjesh Lal, and all the students who have helped in me in various ways, I acknowledge them. And outside the department, there's Dr. Sachin Tiwari, Dr. Jenny Peter, Sri Benny Kurian, Dr. Hemachandran, Dr. Prem Kumar, Sri Krishna Raj, OK Johnny, who have, you know, taken me to various sites and guided me to various sites. And I also, last but the least, but I also wish to extend my gratitude and thanks to Dr. Amrita Sarkar for inviting me to give this talk. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, sir. Rock art itself is really a very vast topic, but yet you have somehow managed to give a very wonderful overview of rock art, starting from the definition, the scope, the importance of studying rock art, methodology, everything, and then of course focusing on Kerala rock art. So I'm sure all the students who are still here in this meet, who are who wish to take up rock art as a research, or we are already researching on rock art, I think this lecture is going to be a very good guide for all of them. Now, we have quite a number of questions in the chat box, but seeing at the shortage of time, because we have a MPhil Viva, which is scheduled very shortly, I will take up the questions by the ones who are still there in the meeting, okay? So Rahul Thomas, are you there? Abhishek Bhomik, are you there? Anisha Shaha, are you there?
Yes, ma'am, I'm here.
Okay. So Anisha has put forth a question, sir. The Bhimbetka paintings also depict men and women walking together. Can you put some light on the fact that what those paintings reflect? Any division of labor on basis of gender, whether the society was patriarchal society?
It's difficult to give an you know, interpretation just because a man and woman is walking together. Whether it has got a gender bias or not, it's something very difficult to answer, because even if you observe in the tribal society, even present ethnic societies, it's the female who actually does the much of the chores, whether it is domestic chores or collecting of firewood, and many of these things are also done by the females. The hunting part and the other aspects are sometimes undertaken by the men. So there was probably some division of labor among the pristine societies also, but definitely they are not reflected. You can't reflect it from paintings. If you go some of the tribe groups, even Africa, it's the men who take up the hunting, and they bring the hunt to the settlement, and then the rest is taken care of by the women folk in that particular habitation. So by basing on paintings, probably we can't definitely come to a conclusion about gender.
Okay, so it seems Abhishek is here, still now here. He has gotten with some other ID. So Abhishek's first question was, where is your first question, Abhishek? Civilizations across the world have flourished with differences in time in various domains of the living society. Coming into the context of rock art or other prehistoric primitive forms of art, what kind of parities and disparities have been found in these art forms across different geolocations? How can these parities or disparities focus on the thought process of people in prehistoric times for similarities in forming a basic common social organization and uniformity in social psychology?
The question itself is huge, and the answer also is huge. So it's not in every given realm, it's not possible to, you know, definitely come to a conclusion, because as humans, what I think would not be the way you think. So definitely to put the same thought process is difficult, but wherever, you know, some sort of iconographic sort of representations are already imbibed into the mind, yes, psychologically, it can be definitely created. But you can't attribute apart from certain symbols which are actually cosmic in nature and things like that, every symbol needn't be attributed the same meaning in every though it is found in rock art, you can't attribute it attribute the same psychological or meaning into those things.
Okay, next is Priya Athiradhan. Priya, are you there? Okay. Priya is not there. Next is from N.A. Mathan. It is commonly, yes, anybody saying anything? N.A. Mathan is telling, sir, it is commonly told that the horse is unknown to ancient Indians, at least up to the end of mature Indus Valley culture period. And the same is evident from Indus Valley findings. Whereas the rock art paintings in places like Tamil Nadu, Kerala, etc. got horses. In the context of horse, why is this kind of difference when it comes to IVC archaeological findings and rock paintings? When and how did the horse reach the tribal people dwelling in the hilly regions of Tamil Nadu, Kerala?
Now, as I said earlier, horses are there in Marayur even today, and they are load-bearing animals into very far in their territory in where habitations are located along the hills. But none of the horses are of local origin. They are brought from the Nilgiri Plateau, a Nilgiri region. They buy it and bring it, and horse. And all the paintings of horses, which are there noticed in these rock paintings, are all of late origin. They are all late origin paintings, because the horses come to appear, from early historic period onwards. Horses are used in warfare and other things as a mode of communications and things. So all these paintings where horses are represented are not late, and not prehistoric or protohistoric or.
N.A. Mathan has another question, sir. He's telling that he has come across a rock art site near Tenmala, Kerala in one of your research papers. He's asking, can you explain about the site in details? What are the steps being carried out to protect and conserve this kind of rock art site?
Which site did he mention?
Tenmala, Kerala.
Okay, Tenmala rock art site is not protected. Some sites have been protected, which I showed you them, Atipara in Marayur has been protected, so has been Edakkal has been protected by state archaeology department, but none of the other caves have been protected, and I don't think there are any other sites which have been protected by the state government or any other authority.
Next question is again by Onisha. She's telling, it is known that in Ezuthala there are many paintings which are of late Mesolithic, but no Mesolithic tools have been found in Kerala rock shelters. Can you please tell us what does this depict? What can be the possible reason behind it?
Now, Deccan College itself, one of Dr. Joglikar's student, Nikhil, had actually worked on the Marayur region, and they had excavated in Marayur also, but they did not find any implements which are dating to Mesolithic or Upper Paleolithic or any of those. They did find church, but that church, things which they found, it is locally known as Chikimukki. And these Chikimukki stones are used for creating fire by local tribes. So in excavations also, they have not been able to find anything which is attributable to Mesolithic or Upper Paleolithic and things like that. So definitely that area was not habited during that particular period, and these paintings do not seem to be affiliated with that. Yeah, because the earliest painting seems to be of those cattle. And we have no evidence of Mesolithic or Neolithic from that area. So the cattle what is depicted, which is treated as the earliest, may only go to Megalithic period.
Okay. Ramnivas Mahesh, are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So he has a question, sir. The pictograph of ladder, as you told, is it a symbol of hierarchy in Buddhism? Sahagnyan, like Arhat, Bodhisattva, Purna Buddha, or is it a symbol of backbone showing various awakening stages of Vajrayan?
I'm not aware of Buddhism's association with, you know, this ladder motif in such aspects. But Buddha is supposed to have, we see, that is represented in sculptures also, in many places. It is there in Bharut sculpture, it is there in Gandhara sculpture, where Buddha is shown ascending the heavens in a ladder and also descending in the heavens after visit of his mother in Trishutha heaven. So a ladder as a means for Buddha to go to Trishutha heaven and come down is represented in sculptures. But the other ones which you asked me, I'm not aware of.
Okay, the next one is by Madhu Kizak Kyle. Some folklorists say that the origin of Theyam from Velan Veriyattam in Sangha period. If some of the pictures in Edakkal cave represents Theyam, can we assume its oldness?
No, oldness of Theyam, antiquity of Theyam is not established from literary sources. If you go by some of the pictographs and the petroglyphs in Edakkal, that is basically a reflection of the tribal society which was then existent. And if you push back the antiquity in 1000 BC, that Theyam as a form was there. Definitely. Now, Theyam gets associated with or gets assimilated into Brahmanism in later periods is another facet of the study. It is part of a ritual which is associated with, you know, ancestors and things like that. Spirits and ancestors.
The next is by Abhiram Saji. What type, kind of tools were used to carving these petroglyphs in Mesolithic and Neolithic period?
Now, in Kerala, to my knowledge, we do not have anything called so-called Mesolithic or Neolithic. I categorically state that they all belong to, even if the earliest ones, if we date it to even 1000 BC, they seem to go only to the Megalithic period. Now, Megalithic period onwards, iron implements were definitely in use. Now, whether they put to use iron implements, definitely they seem to have put into use iron implements when it comes to, you know, carving those very linear forms in Edakkal. They did put to use a very sharp instrument. Now, iron chisels or the iron, you know, such things seem to be, have been used predominantly, especially because I told you that many of these things only go to Megalithic period. Neolithic, the so-called Neolithic cells which have been reported from some places are also associated with megaliths in Kerala. So just getting a cell from somewhere, you need not assign it to Neolithic phase because habitation is missing, pottery is missing. But Neolithic cells have been reported from megalithic context. In Tamil Nadu also, in Kerala also, it has been reported from megalithic context. So even having a Neolithic cell, so-called Neolithic cell, reported does not give us the freedom to associate it with Neolithic, but largely to Megalithic only.
Okay. Prakriti, I think your question was on the same line, so I think you've already got your answer by now. Next is by Chandrika Sunkard. Sir, which zone was more evolved based on rock art evidences?
Which zone?
Was more evolved based on rock art evidences.
Wayanad seems to be the most evolved, especially Edakkal seems to be the most evolved in.
Okay. I think those are all the questions, sir. There's this Vinita Menon, who have requested if you could again share the slide of the book again. Hello? Hello? I think Ajit Kumar, sir, am I audible to everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Ajit Kumar, sir, has, I think there is some network problem from his side. He will join soon. The moment he joins back, I will ask Sable sir to give a official vote of thanks. So I think you all have really enjoyed today's talk. It's been very informative. And is Ajit, sir? I'll just call him. Acha, he's typing something in the WhatsApp. Just Sable sir, I'm just waiting for Ajit sir. What he's telling seems to have lost connect.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Can you join back? Join back. We were left with the vote of thanks.
Yes, sir, I join.
Now I invite our HOD, Dr. Panduram Sable Professor. Sir, please give the vote of thanks.
So good afternoon, all of you. Thank you, sir. Thank you for very informative, very, very wonderful and very long lecture. I think you have covered most of the components of rock art, and therefore it is very helpful to all our students as well as number of the staff and everyone. So the rock art concept, I think it is a clear. I hope everyone enjoy this lecture very well on especially it is organized on rock art studies in India with special reference to Kerala. So by our Ajit Kumar sir, who is the founder of the University of Kerala at Trivandrum. Sir delivered his rock art talk with special reference to the petroglyphs, then pictographs, then cupules, rock art motifs with special examples and case studies from all over the India. Similarly, he taken a nice review of rock art and its development at Indian level with comparison to the some world examples, including North India, Northeast India, central region of Vidarbha zone, Konkan, Karnataka, and lastly, he detailed focus on the rock art in Kerala region with beautiful case histories and their salient features. What is importance of the animal plants which are depicted in these rock shelters with paints? And they are giving enormous information about the that environmental conditions, cultural history, social beliefs, customs, subsidiary patterns, agriculture, and so many kind of information. And similarly, how the interdisciplinary studies is important to understand the concept of the rock shelter, the very well focused. And in addition to that, the importance of the animal and their depictions, similarly, the black magic concept and the different beliefs behind these rock shelters and depicted features, as well as the methods of study of the rock shelters, importance of interdisciplinary studies, and the how this study is means what becoming nowadays very important to the all-time historians, as well as the contextual, cognitive, and conceptual studies and its importance in rock art, sir has explained very well. Lastly, the scientific analysis and the dating technology, how it is useful for the to understand the chronological sequence of the objects, antiquities, and artifacts which are found in the rock shelters of different phases. So he explained with different case histories. And lastly, in case of the Kerala, number of case histories where he worked, that is the Idakkal, Izhuthala, Thoravimala, and Angkor localities, he explained very well. The anthropomorphic figures occurred in laterite rock made for the rock shelters, occurred from Gujarat to Kerala, that is all over the Western Ghat, how it is rich in the different depictions and its importance, sir has explained very well. So I think this is a complete lecture on the rock shelters, not only Kerala, but it is the throughout the case studies of the India, he focused very well. And for this, I, on the behalf of department, as well as on the behalf of me, I thank you to our Ajit Prasad sir for his very informative, systematic, and very long lecture with lot of the case studies and particularly the references, okay, and review of all the sites. And for within a short notice, he ready to accept accepted our invitation and delivered very nice lecture in our archaeology discussion group. Similarly, I thanks to Amrita Sarkar ma'am for conducting this lecture successfully. And similarly, I thanks to you all, audience, the staff and student of Deccan College, as well as the Kerala University and all the other universities of India. And especially I thanks to our past student, who are number of past students are here, especially the our old batch student Dr. Arun Kumar sir was personally throughout the lecture he was here. So thank you, you all. Thank you for once again for joining this lecture, and be safe and take care of yourself from this pandemic situation. And thank you all. Thank you once again.
Thank you, sir, and thank you, everyone. Our next lecture is scheduled on 8 May, 4 p.m. by Dr. Teresa Radzik of the Kennesaw University of USA. The link and the poster will be shared with you, all of you, in due time, and I hope to see all of you and or most of you in our next lecture. Thank you. Thank you for staying with us for so long. Bye. Take care, everyone.